several people coming here a day with cameras, and they just want to take pictures of the pictures. They don't even look at the pictures. They're only here to create some sort of experience or memory of an experience to take home and to show other people, show their friends, stick on Facebook. And I sometimes like to say, fine, yes, we will give you permission to take the photographs, but first, put the camera down and go through the gallery. And then secondly, take the photographs. And we're in several generations now. I mean, since the Second World War, we're in generations that see art through textbooks. You've got to remember, before photography especially, the only way to actually see art was to go and look at it, actually travel and go and see it. In the 18th century, in British culture, it became the very thing, if you were rich and you had the money, to leave Britain for a period of time and go and visit Italy and France and expose yourself to culture in that way. It took a lot of effort. After photography and different forms of publication, it's easy. You just open a textbook. You expose yourself to the art in a textbook, whether formally through art history classes or just informally in a library. But you don't contact the art, you just see a reproduction of it. And there's a big difference, no matter how good the photography, there's a big difference between the reproduction in your book and the original thing. How many people have you heard say, I went to the Louvre on holiday, I had to go and see the Mona Lisa. God, isn't it small? Okay? So you've seen it in a book, it's probably one of the most famous images in Western culture, and they didn't even bother to check the size. They probably said in the label at the bottom of the page. Some art looks much better in the photographs than it does in reality.